Welcome to the show known as Conversations with Ralph Walker. How are you celebrating Dr. King's birthday? Oh, you know it happens every year? You know it's a federal holiday. You didn't realize that after all this time? Well, I'm honored to have here in the studio Terry Miller. How are you doing today, sir?
Very nice to see you again.
Noted photographer for the Monrovia Weekly, or to sum it all up, I'll say Beacon News. Now, Terry, how long have you been employed as a photographer for Beacon News?
17 to 18 years now.
18 years.
And then I became the editor a few years back, so I'm doing a combination of editing and shooting.
All right. Now, some of the viewers out there would probably say, hey, Ralph, you jumped the gun a little early. Let's get into a little bit of early history. Okay. Terry Miller is, how did you get involved? Let's say, with photography. Where are you originally from?
Well, I'm from England, actually. I came over on, believe it or not, the Queen Mary in 1965. And when I go to schools, kids equate, you know, go to, what do they call it, career days.
Yes.
And one child said, Mr. Miller, you came over on the Queen Mary? That's the Mayflower, isn't it? I said, no. So my father was a journalist, a British journalist, and the whole family was transferred over in 1965. So he became a foreign correspondent for the London Daily Telegraph in New York. And that, having grown up with him and seeing all the incredible things that he has done in his life, and particularly when we came to America.
Your dad's name?
Henry Miller.
Okay, Henry Miller.
And he is now passed on about 10 years ago.
So what was his expertise as a journalist? Any particular niche he fell into?
Foreign and policy, politics, specifically politics. He covered Bobby Kennedy and Martin Luther King. And we can get to that at later points. Some very interesting facts that he taught me about journalism was just that don't get into this business because it's crazy.
Is it crazy?
It's crazy. On a local level, it's wonderful. You know, we had that terrible accident a couple of days ago and I covered it. You know, anything can happen in this business, which is great. At any given moment, you can be sent to a major fire, an earthquake, or it could be a ribbon cutting. I like to say ribbon cuttings to riots.
Okay, let me go back a little. As a young kid, obviously hearing your dad discuss different mm-hmm. issues in the house or with a friend, when did that button click onto you that says, you know what, I want to do this?
Well, the button that really clicked was when we came to America. I was 11, and one of the first assignments he had was to cover the Indianapolis 500. He came back with some black and white photographs from the races. And I always loved cars, too, because I was a kid, you know. But he brought these incredible black and white images, and then it would be other major events. He would bring black and white 8x10s home, and I said, that's what I want to do. I want to shoot pictures.
Mm.
And so probably from about 13 or 14, I started getting interested in it, and then girls kind of distracted me for quite a while.
Of course. Now, let me ask you, what was your take on coming to America? I mean, America has so many different images from abroad, from the shores far, far away.
Well, I really thought it was the Wild West. I didn't know what to expect. And we landed in New York. And my first impression of New York was the streets are on fire because the steam's coming out of the subway.
Right? Subway system.
Yeah. It was funny. And everything is huge. All our cars in England are small.
Yes.
American cars, especially in the 60s and
70s. Everything is big in America.
Everything is big. And we stayed in Manhattan for the first couple of months, and I was just, you know, I was a sponge. I was absorbing it all. But when we finally got to go to school, we were sent. We moved to Queens, and then we ultimately moved to a place called Great Neck on Long Island. But the school, my father was so conservative. He insisted that we wear shirts and ties and short trousers, We stood out like sore thumbs, as you can imagine.
So how were you treated by the school children? Who's this guy?
Oh, my God. We had so many girlfriends, you wouldn't believe it.
Really?
Do you know the Beatles? Of course we know the Beatles.
Oh, because you're from England.
Oh, it was great.
Oh, okay.
Having an English accent, looking a little bit different, talking funny. We had a lot of friends. My brother and I, we had great time in high school.
So how many brothers and sisters did
you have? One brother, one sister.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. What's their name?
Mandy is my sister. She's the youngest. And she was only about 18 months when we came over.
Oh.
So she was a baby. And
so she's the closest to the American eyes.
Oh, yeah. And my brother, too, who has become an American citizen. I, on the other hand, have not. And I don't want to become an American citizen. I'm a British subject, but a loyal American with a green card. I
Trump is looking for you.
Oh, God. No, I'm a green card holder. I can legally work here and do everything. The only thing I can't do is run for office.
Okay. Now, and school life was like, what year were you in school? What was the 60s?
65. I graduated in 71. Graduated high school in 71.
Turbulent times, Vietnam.
Very turbulent times, yeah. A lot of protests.
Predominantly all white school? Or how was
this? The high school where I was, we had a couple of African Americans, but very few Chinese. It was pretty much lily white, yeah.
Okay.
On Long Island.
Relationships.
Relationships?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Did you interact with the black folks in
school? Oh, absolutely, yeah. I had some really good friends who were on, but I wasn't into sports.
Okay.
And so most of the.
Not to pigeonhole them, but
not to pigeonhole them, but no, that's true. But a lot of these guys that there were only like three or four, if I remember, and they were always on the football team.
Of course, who else is going to fill the stadiums?
You know, but I was definitely not into sports. I was into girls and music. So we, you know, had a rock and roll band and that kind of stuff.
Okay. So if you're a viewer and you just tune in and you're wondering what's going on, I'm interviewing Terry Miller, associated with Beacon News, the Monrovia Weekly, and a gamut of other independent papers associated with Beacon News. As a photographer, but as a writer, he really caught my attention with this article here, focusing on Dr. King. Amazing article. All right, let's get back to you and your journey as you move on. You leave high school and you go to?
I went back to England, actually. I was very confused at that time. There was a lot going on. Vietnam was, you know,
fever
raging.
Pitch.
It really was. And my father had said, he was very much nonviolent man. Okay. And my father had met Martin Luther King.
What was that like?
Oh, well, we used, believe it or not, we used to get Christmas cards from Coretta King every year, long past his assassination in 68.
Really?
And it was, my mom still got them somewhere. Yeah, very, very moving Christmas cards, just thanking him for his coverage. And I wish I had kept even just one or two articles that he did, but.
You don't have any?
No, I don't have a single one. And of course, it's pre-digital.
Yes,
so
yes.
That was.
Unless you find one at a yard sale or somewhere.
Right. And the chances of that are pretty slim because being a British newspaper, you know, over here.
You're not going to find. Well, then you never know.
But my dad told me one of the reasons I wrote this about Dr. King is it's always something that has really touched my heart. The struggle, the eternal struggle, and it's still an eternal struggle. But my dad was on a plane with Bobby Kennedy during one of his campaign stops, and Bobby Kennedy had heard the pilot had announced that Martin Luther King had been killed, and there was a hush in the plane, and I guess they made an unexpected stop. They said, we have to go. We just have to go. And a few months later, Bobby Kennedy was killed. You know, just.
First you hear King, and then.
Then Bobby Kennedy. King was, I believe, April, right?
Yes.
And Bobby Kennedy was it August? It was the same year, 68.
Yeah, summertime. It was a rather hot day, I believe it was.
Yeah. And so my father covered both of those stories. And
you don't have either one?
Mm-mm.
Wow.
Heartbreaking,
amazing.
Huh? My mother may. She used to be the family archivist, but she's getting on, so.
How old is your mom?
She's 86.
How old is, and what's mom's name?
Mom's name is Patricia.
Patricia
Elizabeth.
She Hello out there. Eventually you'll get to see this show. Oh, that's amazing. Now, what was going on in your household where there was some empathy with black people? I mean, what was your dad's people like, or your mom's people, grandma and grandpa? How did this come about?
That's a good question. I guess just because I'm perhaps more open-minded than some other people, and you don't look, you know, you don't look at color. You look at the content of their character.
Well, the reason why I say that is because we know and is well documented that racism is taught. It is programmed.
Definitely, yes. So a lot of parents bringing up the kids the wrong way, they teach them terrible things.
So I'm thinking, as your dad covered Dr. King, everyone wasn't happy about that.
In my family?
Well, not necessarily in your family, but maybe surrounding folks.
I never heard any animosity about him covering Dr. King, or in fact, quite the opposite. It was more like, wow, fantastic. You know, you're meeting and talking to an amazing individual who's really trying to change something in the world.
That wasn't the media in America.
No, this is
quite the opposite.
Well, see, this is British media. Mm-hmm. He was covering it from a British perspective, for a British audience.
Yes.
And I think racial relations in England at that time were nothing like they were
in America.
The Chicago race riots, we didn't have anything like that. Mm-hmm. There were pockets in London where
yes.
there's definitely some racial trouble.
Yes.
Notting Hill being one of them. But there's poverty everywhere, and it's not just, you know, it's not just blacks and whites. It's in England, it's Turkish and it's Pakistani.
Okay.
A lot of Indian people.
Yes, third world countries.
Third world countries.
Former British colonies.
Former, yes.
Yeah, I guess you could put it
yes,
like that,
exactly.
Even from Jamaicans.
Yeah, a lot of Jamaicans. Also. Yeah, exactly.
Yes. All right, so you go home to England during this turbulent period, during the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
What were you doing there?
I was playing the drums.
Oh, okay.
I was in the rock and roll group.
Okay, you had a band. What was the name of the band?
The band, we had a couple of names. One was called Dice.
Okay.
And we got nowhere. To talk about a bad choice for rolling the dice.
Was never discovered.
Never discovered, no. And the other one was the Horace Coker Band, and we just played... we played throughout southwest England.
Okay.
And,
what did your dad think of this?
Oh, my dad just thought I was nuts. He said, "You're never going to make it as a rock and roll star." I said, I'm having fun.
Having fun.
And then, you know, once in a while I'd write something and occasionally it'd get published. And then finally I just started saying, I've got to be back in America.
Okay,
so.
I was going to ask, when did the Great Awakening happen?
79. Well, actually, the Great Awakening happened in 77. But it took 2 years to convince the United States Immigration Service that I had spent the majority of my life, or a good portion of my life, in the United States, and that I would like to come back. So I had to get my own green card at that point.
Mm-hmm.
Up until when I left when I left America in the early 70s after high school, my brother and I and sister were under my father's visa. It was called an I visa, information visa they give for journalists. And I don't think they do that anymore. It's a different system. But so 77. So it took about two or three years to get all the paperwork going. And I finally got my green card and came over here.
Oh, okay.
And
so what did you do?
Fell in love with a French girl, moved to New York. moved to California. Sorry, met her in New York, moved to California. And a few years after that, she decided she didn't want to...
It's over.
Bye. Yeah, she says, "I do not like you Americans anymore. I'm out of here." Yeah, she just wanted to fly
Viva
the coop.
Viva la France. Goodbye.
Yeah, I said, au revoir. So anyway, when I moved to... with her to Santa Barbara, that's when I started working for the newspapers. So 79 was really when my first job as a photographer, writer.
Okay, first picture that really caught someone's eye.
Gorbachev and Ronald Reagan coming off a plane in at Santa Barbara Airport.
Oh, quite amazing. Yeah, how did you get access to that? What paper was it?
The group of papers then was called South Coast Community Newspapers. It was a group not unlike the group of papers I work for now, community newspapers covering Santa Barbara, Goleta, Carpinteria. And so we had, you know, we had Santa Barbara County issued press credentials.
So Gorbachev and
Gorbachev and Ronald Reagan, yeah. And he arrived in Santa Barbara Airport, a tiny little airport, and they had a little area set up for the press. And I was very excited to be there with one of my cheap and cheerful cameras and a very long lens, and I got a really nice shot of Gorbachev.
You still have that?
Oh yeah, I do. I'll make you a copy.
Okay, quite interesting. Yes. Tear down that wall. I guess that's their role
Gorbachev.
In history in the end.
Absolutely.
Now, being a photographer and you're covering an event like that, do journalists jockey for position? Does it get sort of rough up in there?
It can. And in this particular case in Santa Barbara, it wasn't too bad. But when I moved down to L.A., of course, it's, you know, it's every man for himself. Yeah, it's a battlefield sometimes. But most people in the profession, if you've been in the business long enough, are respectful of one another. And they, you know, one of the friends I have got to know over the years is Nick Utt, who took that famous photograph of the little girl running from the napalm.
Oh, yes.
And he's still around. And he's one of the nicest and most unpretentious photographers you'll ever meet. Tiny guy.
I always wanted to meet her. She was in Pasadena.
Him. Oh, the girl, yeah.
3 years ago, like that. And
what a
picture that's etched forever in people's minds.
Well, you know, he and the other photographer, Eddie Adams, probably single-handedly helped stop the war in Vietnam with those two images. Remember the image of the general
getting his head blown off.
Yep. So those two.
The picture that I forgot to bring today. Well, maybe in post production we'll put it up.
Maybe
we can
find
there.
That. Yeah.
So all right. So you come back with that picture and everyone is saying, "Wow, great shot! We'll run with this." How was that decided?
Well, in those days, we had, you know, I was developing film, so it was all black and white, so I had to, I would make a contact sheet, I'd give it to the editor, and they'd say, okay, that's the one, and then they'd run it on front page. And for the first few years of my career, that's the way we did things. We made contact sheets, I would look at them and suggest something, but it was always the editor who would say, have final okay, which is going in, and...
What's your take on that? You ever had a picture that you thought should go in and the editor said, "Yeah, we ain't going to."
Oh, God, yes. Hundreds of times. Mm-hmm. And then I've had editors cut off chef's hat. I had a beautiful shot of a chef cooking something and they cut the big hat off in half. I thought, no, that's a little silly.
Which is part of his repertoire.
Right. And they converted a vertical shot and made it horizontal. Ruined everything. But so now that's... In my position as photo editor and editor with a paper, I have complete control over that. So it's wonderful. Now I can dictate.
You can decide. Yes.
Right. And you've seen many of my images.
Yes.
And so it's important to be able to have that kind of control.
All right. As we go through the journey of your life, Terry Miller, and you in Santa Barbara, what brought you to L.A.? What was the migration from Santa Barbara?
Very interesting. Well, I was working for newspapers in Santa Barbara, and then the company, South Coast Community Newspapers, went into receivership because of some bad business dealings, and I don't know what, but ultimately, we went to work one morning, and there's a sign on the door, cease and desist. And so we thought, oh my God.
Out of a job.
Out of a job. All of a sudden out of a job. This was in 94. And, you know, I'd been working diligently to try to get up the ladder. And then, amazingly enough, this was just in the beginning of the internet. And I found a friend who had a computer access to an internet and got a job within... Less than a month up in San Luis Obispo, moved up there, was the chief photographer for the Times Press Recorder, which was a Pulitzer-owned paper, and covering Grover Beach, Oceano, San Luis Obispo, Pismo Beach, and Pomo.
So biggest thing that happened up there?
Biggest thing that happened up there was the El Nino.
El Nino. What did El Nino, the little boy, what did it do?
The little boy that brought lots of rain to Central and all over California. And one of, and I was just getting involved with my soon-to-be wife. Mm-hmm. And I was down here, actually, in L.A., visiting her because she was living here and obviously still is. And when I got a call that two police officers had died on a road that had been washed away and that I had to go and cover it. And so I had to zoom back up to near San Luis Obispo to cover that. And it was a nerve-wracking time. A lot of rain.
How do you get access into an area like that?
The press credentials, you know, usually as long as you're accredited for, you know, you have some kind of press credential, and usually states, and in those days, actually, CHP issued. So I just pull up to a scene, and I show them this, and they wave you on. They say, you know, unless it's extremely dangerous, and then, of course.
And you get to get as close as to a...
You can get pretty close access, yeah. I mean, it depends on the situation. It also depends on the officers and the people who are...
And the lens of the camera.
And the lens, too. Like fires, for example, they're actually relatively easy to shoot with a long lens, you know, and aircraft coming in and dropping off that FOSCHECK.
So how long were you in that area?
In San Luis Obispo?
Yeah.
4.5 years.
Okay.
4.5 years. And then I married Julia down here. And she said, we have to pick straws. So she won. I won too.
Okay. Okay.
So I moved here. And then again, I moved down here with no job.
And, lucky rascal.
And I met Vaughn, the owner of this newspaper, and he hired me pretty much on the spot.
And Vaughn has been doing a tremendous job.
He has. He's been doing a really good job.
Covering all the various communities in the San Gabriel Valley. Very balanced, I must say.
We try to be balanced, and we try to be as fair. And the one good thing is we're independent. We're not controlled by any advertisers or... And they don't influence us. We don't. We really try to be like that Fox slogan. We really do try to be fair and balanced.
Okay, is a reality.
Yeah, and we try and encourage people to bring their opinions to light too via letters to the editor.
All right, first big story with Beacon News.
For me, the first big story for me was when David March was killed, the police officer or sheriff's deputy, and that was a horrible story to cover.
Which happened
in right near Irwindale. It was borderline Monrovia. I think it's not even really considered Irwindale, but it's on that road, and it was just a traffic stop, and this crazy guy just started firing, killed David March. And that was very, very sad, very sad day. But then there have been a lot of fires since then, earthquakes, and then, you know, the routine assignments. Sometimes routine assignments can be fun because you get to meet characters like you.
Oh, characters like me. Interesting. Now, as you cover... let's talk about your role as a photographer.
Mm-hmm.
And when I think of recent events, like in Ferguson or Pasadena, when an incident where the young black man was gunned down as these police officers did a Wild Wild West type shootout, in a sense, well, the person didn't have a gun, but they thought that he had a gun.
What?
And there's a whole lot of things that's been coming out now.
Right, because of the report.
This is wrong.
Right, that the police didn't follow procedure.
Yes.
And that story is a very sad story. I know the victim's mother and father, met them both. And the whole reason that boy was shot that night was because somebody lied to the police about
him carrying
a weapon. And so they went crazy, and they did everything wrong. They didn't put the lights and sirens on, And they just assumed. They made a lot of assumptions.
Just a tragedy.
Very tragic.
But
very
that
tragic.
Story was pushed in the background, in a sense, because of what happened with another African-American male, right? The situation with Brown in...
In Ferguson.
Yes.
Yes. Well, that would... But then it started escalating again because... Yeah. There were more and more shootings, continued shootings,
right.
And it seemed to be almost every week or every other week. And it was becoming, the dialogue, national dialogue was, what are these police officers doing? Why are they killing the black men?
Right.
We still don't know.
Right. But there's an example also in, let me get it right, in Orange County of a homeless man being savagely beaten by police officers. So not to knock the criminal justice officers that are doing a good job. You don't hear too much about them, but it's the bad apples that just
right.
explodes to why is this still going on?
And that is the $64,000 question. Why? Are we racially profiling? Are police officers so gung-ho that they have to go out and just... Are we going to Wild West again? Are we going backwards in history?
And to interject that technology has changed everything.
Absolutely. And look at the number of videos that are coming out.
Now you don't have to wait for a photographer to come.
No.
The photographer is that person with a phone.
It's the man on the street.
Yep. Saying, I'll send you this.
Right. Exactly.
To the point now where officers must wear cameras.
Body cameras. Exactly.
Amazing. So... Your role when the event unfolds, I don't know if you've been involved in any community unrest.
I have.
Okay, explain the situation where you're in, but...
It was actually at last year's Black History Parade.
Mm-hmm.
The young woman who, Jasmine, I think is her name.
Yes. Race Matters, or...
Yeah, for Black Lives Matter.
Yes.
And there was a very peaceful... parade coming down honoring
in Pasadena,
which tradition is going to be happening next month again, and this woman Jasmine and all these Black Lives Matter individuals was screaming through a megaphone saying how terrible the Pasadena police officers are. The timing to me was, I understood the passion and
right.
the reason why, but the timing was wrong. This was a time to celebrate
right.
Martin Luther King,
yeah.
Black America, celebrate Black history, mm-hmm. just celebrate the achievements of some of the people, Jackie Robinson,
right.
people
yeah.
Who are important in Pasadena. And it was, the police were very, very well controlled. They didn't do anything. They didn't arrest her. But people are just looking at her saying, wow, this is not really the time. She felt it was the time.
She felt it was the time.
Hmm. And I've noticed that organization, Black, and I think we've talked about this before, not on television, but the anger that Black Lives Matter caucus seems to have when interrupted Bernie Sanders at some event.
Yes.
It was just...
Rude.
It was rude. There are ways to get the message across nonviolently.
Well, the sad part with Bernie Sanders, if I can interject that, is that they didn't know his history.
Exactly.
That was the sad part about it.
They were not aware of it, and which brings us to a lot of questions you may have. One of the things is, who knows about Dr. Martin Luther King? Are we teaching it?
Where is he at now? Which brings us back to the article that's in the Beacon News. No matter what community you may live in, if you pick up a paper, you'll find a very very interesting narrative written by Terry Miller. So let's jump right into this. What made you do this, and how did you pull it off to be the front page?
Well, we felt the timing was important because, number one, we come out on Thursdays. Dr. King's birthday is today,
mm-hmm.
it's Friday. People have a weekend to think about things. They have a day off on Monday. some people, mm-hmm. and I wanted to mention what was going on locally, but also do a little history about not what Dr. King meant, but what hasn't changed.
Right. Where are we at?
Where are we now? Yeah, okay. We are a violent society. We have a lot of shootings, and we have a lot of terrible things happening all the time. But there's a lot of good things too. And what Martin Luther King was advocating was nonviolence and education. Simple as that.
Okay, even if we just explore the entertainment side, let's say you want to get away from it all, go deep into my archives, and when Denzel and Halle Berry won their Oscars, two black folks in one night, we thought, hallelujah, things have changed.
Up.
The time has come. And then when we fast forward, it was like, I gotcha.
Not one black face. Amazing.
It is disheartening. I think not only to the white actors and actress, also for them to know that, okay, I'm competing with the best. That's probably my phone. But we'll let it ring. We'll let it ring. And when you think about it, Hollywood, some of the people that voted then are still alive and they're still voting.
Uh-huh.
And what happened? What's with the mindset? What's with the mindset? I know you can't speak for all of white America.
Mm-mm.
And then you're from the shores of England. But what do you think, as a photographer and as a journalist that gets to be in the rooms with some of these people sometimes as they discuss and you take pictures to capture the moment?
Try to, yeah.
What is going on? What's going on in America? From you, I say you have like a third eye, because from a distance you were brought up different.
Yeah.
But what's going on in America where we're not moving forward?
I think we're very weirdly insular kind of society, and people are just, they're very self-involved. We're much more self-involved than we ever were. And
I don't know, they're telling me something. I don't know exactly what it is. Slight break.
I was just going to say, while the camera was on him, you could turn off your phone.
Oh.
While he's talking, you can
turn. All right, go ahead. They're telling me to take a break in action. Sorry about that, talking about technology.
Right.
I got my baseball signals now.
All right, go ahead on. We're talking.
So yeah, I think we're very much...
Why so much discomfort in white America when you talk about people of color trying to achieve equality? Why such discomfort? On the whole, white folks have everything, but why are they still feel threatening by the presence of a young black person?
Media has a huge amount to do with this. The misrepresentation, films like going back to the 30s where the servants were black.
Yes,
yeah. The stereotypes. Promoting stereotypes. Still happens today. Images of that white CHP officer beating that woman on the highway, remember?
Yeah.
I knew that attorney. I know that attorney who got her a big settlement, Carrie Harper. And she's an African-American woman. And every time I talk to her about something that's going on in Pasadena or in the world, she's just like, she throws her hands up, says, this is insane. I don't know what's going on. We can't stop it. There's hatred. There's a lot of hatred out there. But I like to think...
But who's feeding fires of hatred? Hatred can't grow unless someone
is throwing
a log on it.
You brought it up earlier, and you made it an incredible point. It's the home. It starts at the home.
Mm-hmm.
If hatred is your parents teach you things, what's right and wrong,
mm-hmm.
and your immediate siblings and friends and school, of course. And I, in talking to my CEO just the other day, I found out that his nephew, who goes to a private school, has never heard of Dr. King.
So Dr. King is passé. He's yesterday.
We're not teaching Dr. King anymore. We're not teaching our children well. And this is a private school. Now, public schools, I think, hopefully, they're still teaching. But why can't private schools
embrace?
And it's not just Black history; it's American history.
Yes. And that's what's missing. It's American history.
And
most of the books come out of Texas, and Texas doesn't believe in people of color in many different ways.
No.
So if Dr. King was alive today, and you sort of touched on his thoughts, and why don't you share some of the things in the paper that...
Well, I think Dr. King would be deeply saddened with some of the things that... Because I think there a lot of people are trying to... Who want to emulate Dr. King, mm-hmm. like Jesse Jackson, mm-hmm. People like that, have become almost media pawns. They're very high visibility. Whereas Dr. King would be willing to go to jail for just about anything.
Right.
And one of the points in the story, I think that I made was that. Initially, when he got his Pulitzer Prize,
mm-hmm. read it to the audience.
Well, this really touched me when I read the speech again, and he said that I believe that unearned truth and unconditional love will have the final word in reality. This is why right temporarily defeated is stronger than evil triumphant. Mm. Now that was powerful. That's right. A powerful statement.
I think even the current president. Barack Obama. And the State of the Union message echoed those same words.
Right.
But someone might say, well, where is that truth?
Hmm.
It's being suppressed. When is it going to unfold and when?
Is it going to unfold or is it going to evolve? I mean, are we going to, we're either going, you know, segregation still exists. I firmly believe it. And you look at Northwest Pasadena and East Pasadena. The difference is phenomenal, and it's sad. It's an economics, and I don't know what we can do, how we can make it better.
I think all we can do is try to get along. If I can interject, I think it's the racism. Is the main obstacle in the destruction of the middle class.
Absolutely.
We're so busy fighting each other as the middle class.
Right.
And what do the middle class want? Good jobs.
A home.
A home.
Security.
Education for their children.
Mm-hmm.
They want that generation to be better than what they have, which is noble and good. But somehow we're so divided with extreme political folks, I won't mm-hmm. drop any names, that we can't see what's really going on.
That's true.
We're such a divided nation that we're not coming together to solve the problems. It's like fear and hate dominate. Let fear and hate be the... Let that be the thing.
Right, and that's why this election is so... So bizarre this year.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
What's going on? And
what started off as a joke is turned into a reality.
I know. It's actually become a reality show.
You know, well, people laugh and say, there's no way this guy would be the front runner.
Right.
And like 2 weeks away, we're going to find out. Okay.
He stands a pretty darn good chance now, you know. Yeah. But he's waking up a lot of people, they say. They say he's waking up people.
I don't think they ever were asleep.
I don't think they were asleep either.
I think they were just looking for a person to promote what they think and say.
Exactly, because they don't have the guts to say it.
Right.
And he says all these horrible things about women, about Mexicans.
But the
Mexicans.
Sad part is he gets away with it.
Yeah.
For example, NBC is like they fired him, but then it brings him back to Saturday Night Live. What a contradiction.
Yeah, it is. It's all about money, Ralph. I think money rules in political races. That's the big factor here is money. And somebody like Donald Trump seems to have an endless amount of it, and he doesn't care. He just doesn't care. And that's not the man you want in the White House. You want somebody who cares.
Yes.
If he doesn't care about his fellow man or the woman that's interviewing him on CNN, what's he going to do for you and me? Nothing. No. He's just going to think he's all about Donald Trump and about
how can I make more money?
More money, or how can I become more famous and maybe grow that hair?
That hair. Okay. But so what is the answer? And I think one candidate pushes it out there is that young people better grab this political system. They better find some way to get involved. There's one thing to say, race, Black Lives Matter, but if you're not eligible to put somebody in office, how much power do you have?
That's a very good question. Yeah, exactly.
And you know, if they had a candidate and said, okay, you vote tomorrow, how many of them would say, I'm not even registered, I can't vote?
Apathy is huge. I mean, it's people don't want to vote anymore.
But there's no apathy for hate.
I know.
That's the scary part.
Well, again, goes back to what you're taught and what your beliefs are, where you grew up. But you can unlearn hatred.
Yes.
You can learn to really care about your fellow man. I work with a lot of different people over the years, and I've never had any tension like I've seen in the United States in the last couple of years, especially. It's gotten more and more divided.
And in people, even in politics, even...
Absolutely.
Eisenhower Republicans, Ronald Reagan Republicans.
Right.
George Bush Republicans, they all say, well, this ain't the party that used to run the government.
Right. Well, it wasn't even, I mean, the original Republican Party was actually a good thing. And in fact, if history is correct, Dr. Martin Luther King was probably a Republican.
Yes, he was initially. His dad was, I know.
Right. So, but those Republican beliefs were for better housing, justice for all. It wasn't the me generation. It wasn't all about money.
Yes.
It just really wasn't. It was about equality.
So now, when Nixon came along with the Southern strategy, put a little religion in it also, and things just went downward, I think.
That was probably one of the most divisive times in American history, when Nixon was in power and then when he ultimately had to resign for his thievery and skullduggery and God knows what. And I think people like the Kennedys, if Bobby Kennedy hadn't been assassinated...
Might be a different world right now.
I think so. I think it stood for something a little bit different. When Jack Kennedy was killed, of course, in 63, that's when America really, really changed. But when Martin Luther King in 68, in April, and then Bobby Kennedy in June, the same year.
And the destruction of so many young lives in the Vietnam War.
In the war. So
that took a lot of 63,000 people.
Unbelievable.
That was the core of, to me, leadership that wanted that change, who were in foxholes with black men saying, we in this together.
We're in this together.
First time ever.
Right.
And then they come back home and then it's like it's in total disarray. They're not respected. They were just used as a tool in the war that Secretary of Defense would later go on, Russ, but later on and say the war was wrong. He lived to say that. And it's just, God, I go off just
that
thinking
was,
about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, very, very sad time in America's history. Probably one of the most awkward things in American history ever, for the country.
That has a ripple effect.
And it always will. And in fact, it's interesting you brought up Vietnam because they're trying to get a Vietnam memorial in Arcadia.
Okay.
They're trying to build a memorial, and that's something that's always been left out. You know, it's always World War II, World War One, but now they're gonna. So that's good for.
So that is progress.
To recognize the sacrifices blacks and whites made during Vietnam, and why they went to the stupid war in the first place.
Motivated
by money.
And drugs.
And drugs.
Because it's well documented.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So what do you see on the horizon?
As far as the future of...
Yes, race relations and I mean, you know, it's a very startling piece that you wrote, but where is the hope at?
I think there's hope. The hope, to me, would be in the younger generation being taught the very things we're talking about today, and not skirting the issue, not just saying Martin Luther King did this and he made a speech, I have a dream. He did so much more.
Right.
So much more, and that's really all he's known for now.
Yes, a sound bite.
It's a sound bite.
I had
exactly.
a dream, and that's it.
Exactly, and it's become a holiday, so people say...
Four-day holiday.
Yeah, so it's another four-day weekend, you know, three-day holiday or whatever it is, three-day weekend. And it should be a day on, not a day off.
Right.
It should be a day to remember and to do something to...
reach out to your neighbor. Help
someone
that has something less than what you have.
And it doesn't have to be black or white. It just has to be compassion.
People to people.
People
to
compassion.
People.
Yeah.
And trying to figure out a way to drop the race thing and think of.
I don't think we'll ever be
race.
Able to. We'll never be able to drop the race thing, unfortunately, purely because the physics. People are visual, and they have long memories too. If something happened to them, let's say I was attacked by a black man in New York, for example, I might. Think that all black men,
right?
But I don't, and that hasn't happened to me. But I know people it has happened to, and they have. Or if a Mexican had attacked me and done something terrible,
but
that's the way people think.
But think of the dynamics of that.
I know
black folks don't hold on to slavery to that point.
Absolutely, I hope not.
So why is it the white folks do?
Good question.
Wasn't that psychic when you think about it? Okay, because just to read a chapter of slavery would make you not want to embrace almost any white person.
Absolutely. I mean,
is riveting in itself.
Completely, and you know, as somebody like me, I can't answer that because I haven't lived in your skin, so I don't know.
So that compassion. And to reach out and to understand a person's plight is what I think Dr. King tried to drive home to America.
He did.
You know, you got to have that compassion, but you also need some sort of forgiveness. Otherwise, you're not going to move forward.
Yeah, and you need forgiveness in not just religious ways.
Yes.
You need, and I think probably maybe. This is what we're aiming for. We're looking for somebody like Martin Luther King.
And he's not.
And there's nobody like Martin Luther King right now. It's not a Barack Obama.
Right.
It's not. It's certainly not Donald Trump.
Right.
It seems to be, you know, the TV hosts.
Yes.
Everything is geared around television. Yeah. Television is huge in America.
But King left us so much documented. Written, spoken, that is within us.
It should be within us.
Yes.
It should be.
I think it's there. It may be dormant. I think young people are making an effort to create some change, and they take some part of nonviolence, like the situation in Chicago, where they just shut down the Miracle Mile.
Right.
Okay. But then the next step of negotiation, they don't seem to quite get, you know? Because when you looked at that protest in Chicago, and I'm originally from Chicago, I know the stench of racism there, that's still there, that it wasn't just black people demonstrating, it were people of all colors there demonstrating, police shootings, okay? But somehow it's like, okay, after we do this, how do we grab hold of the political machinery to really make changes?
The only way you're going to make changes is voting and getting people to vote. And that's the hardest thing, to get people to the polls. Look at the last few elections, even here locally. Less than 20%. Actually, Arcadia had 10% turnout.
Affluent Arcadia?
10%, 10 to 11% turnout. The Monrovia election, when Tom Adams, low turnout again, extremely low turnout. A little bit better than Arcadia, not much. But, and why is that? Apathy. They just think, same thing is going to happen. Doesn't matter who I vote for, whether it's on a national, municipal, or most hyper-local level on, in school elections even.
And then a lack of involvement.
Very much. And a lot of the lack of involvement, I believe, comes down to entertainment and these devices we all carry around with us.
Yes.
And the younger generation are absolutely addicted to this. I see people sitting at coffee shops when they should be conversing, like you and I, and they're on their phones.
What about dinner time? Three people at the table and they had a phone. And
Right, exactly. Or you see people in the supermarkets talking to themselves. That's the strangest thing.
Yes.
I'm thinking, excuse me? Oh, I'm busy. I'm on the phone.
And what would they do if there was a grid breakdown and you couldn't use the device?
Couldn't use your digital time, right, or your phones. That would be great.
I don't
24,
think people,
24 would, hours without digital would be wonderful.
Would they know even how to approach someone?
Well, we recently had a computer crash at the office, and it was really quite dramatic because we couldn't do anything. For several days, we were scratching our heads trying
What's
to figure
next?
Out
how do
we do this? How do we get the paper out? We're not able to do things because we couldn't access the files we needed to get. So I say bring back the typewriter.
Bring back. Start banging on it. Well, there's a whole lot of folks that wouldn't have a clue about a typewriter. What the heck is that you're talking about?
What is a typewriter?
I know a keyboard, but
that's right.
A typewriter is another thing.
Well, they wouldn't know what a telex machine is, and telex machines, what my father used to use to transmit copy to London from New York office.
That's
and that wasn't that long ago.
Oh, you could text now. So.
Yeah, just text everything, right.
All right, I want to commend you for coming here on the show.
Thank you, Ralph. It's been a pleasure.
I think in the studio we're going to take a look at some of your award-winning photography.
Oh, thank you.
And sign off on that. I want to thank you again
thank you
so
very
much.
And thank you very much
for doing an article on Dr. King, not just for black folks, but for any and everybody that can pick up a newspaper and read.